This is London's most fashionable laboratory spot. Here, film stars rub shoulders with royalty in an atmosphere of cosmopolitan sophistication.
Good evening.
Excuse me, sir. Are you a member?
I'm sorry, I'm not. I'm from American television. I'm doing an interview downstairs.
I'm sorry, sir. You must be a member to go in here.
Would it help if I told you that I was the Duke and Duchess of Windsor?
Oh, sorry, sir. I didn't recognize you, madam. Well, actually, sir, there is a £5 waiting list.
I understand. It's one of the blue ones, right, isn't it? Thank you very much indeed. I love your Oxford accent.
Lovely. Follow your nose, sir.
I mean, the individuality of you guys, as well as his uniqueness as a director, it's really was a great marriage in both pictures so far, you know. I think it's exciting when he's directing you in your first role away from the group.
Well, I wouldn't have accepted probably if it hadn't been him. I would have been too nervous. No. I mean, I can make a fool of myself in front of him because I know him.
What does this character give you a chance to do? In what light does it show you, as opposed to anything you've done in the past?
Well, it just is completely opposed to anything I've done in the past. Now I'm just a different person in it.
Is that why you took the part?
I took it because I was interested in the film and interested in trying my wings at something else. And I felt like doing something for a change, you know. And this just happened to come up.
Does this mean that all of the boys are going to be trying different things as you go along, John?
Well, I can't speak for the others, you know, but George has just got back from India, trying India.
I saw a picture of him with a mustache the other day picking up that teacher of the sitar at London Airport.
Oh, yeah, he travelled with him, I think, from India, that's his teacher.
He flipped over that instrument, didn't he?
Well, yeah, well, that fellow that's teaching him is one of the all-time greats, you know, so he was lucky that the fellow would accept him as a pupil. He doesn't just have anybody.
Will you be using the sitar as a regular sound, as a regular part of the future?
No, I mean, the sitar just happens to have come in useful on a couple of tracks, but it's really nothing to do with it, you know. That's George's own scene.
It won't be a part of the regular albums or records,
no, unless it's called for.
Yeah.
No, George will obviously write more numbers where the sitar's involved if he's... feels like it.
You know what's marvelous, John, in the last couple of years? The wonderful, wonderful songs that have come out of you and Paul, and as always when a new group cracks through, the skeptics, the doubters, and so forth, and finally the proof, which was always there, finally, you know, everybody realized, hey, wow, these guys really are great songwriters, you know, something that you knew all the time, but
then
these marvelous
really
standards come.
You don't know till it happens.
But nobody thought you could write songs like Michelle and Yesterday.
No, because they were too busy just looking at the Beatle image. Yeah.
Hey, can I have a word? Are the Beatles going to go their own ways in 1967?
They could be, you know, on our own or together. We're always involved with each other, whatever we're doing. Maybe.
Could you ever see a time when, in fact, you weren't working together?
I could see us working not together for a period, but we'd always get together for one reason or other. Like, I mean, you need other people for ideas as well, but, you know, and we all get along fine.
Will you be doing films on your own next year?
No, I don't want to make a career of it. I did it just because I felt like doing it. Dick Lester asked me, and I said yes. And I wouldn't have done it if the others hadn't liked it. You know? Yeah. They said fine, because we were on holiday anyway.
Do the others have film ambitions on their own?
No, nobody's particularly interested in it. I'm not all that mad on it.
You know? What do you really want to do? I mean, do you write songs?
I don't know. I just want to do a few things, you know.
Yeah. You haven't really decided exactly what...
No, I'll try a few things, you know, but I just... found out a bit more about films doing that.
What's this? The songwriting team thing will keep going on, whatever happens, will it?
Yeah, we'll probably carry on writing music forever, you know.
Paul, good evening.
Hello.
John Edwards, right here.
How are you?
Can I just have a brief word with you?
Yeah.
If you never toured again, would it worry you?
I don't know. No, I don't think so.
Wouldn't worry you.
But because the only thing about that, you see, is that performance for us, see, it's gone downhill, performance, because we can't develop when no one can hear us, you know what I mean? So for us to perform, it's difficult, gets difficult each time.
You mean they don't listen to you, and therefore you don't want to do that?
Oh yeah, we want to do it, but if we're not listened to, then, and we can't even hear ourselves, then we can't improve in that. We can't get any better. So we're trying to get better with things like recording.
What is it? How are you? Can I stop you?
Well...
have a brief word with you. I just want to ask you, do you think that in the new year that you're going to be going your own ways instead of being
a
group?
No.
No?
No.
George, definitely not.
What about another word?
How are you?
Merry Christmas!
How are you?
Fine, fine.
Can I ask you a few questions?
Yes, yes.
Well, then I'll turn you around this way then, all
Which
right?
way?
This way. No, this
Hello?
Way. You're looking very smart anyway.
Yes, I am. Well, I had a bath.
What's all this about the Beatles are going to do less together in the new year?
Yeah, we won't be too... The thing is, you see, to do things together, the four of us, it's going to be the old things all over again, you know.
You don't
so,
want to do that?
No, we don't want to do, you know, what we've done already. So the thing is, because of the film, you know, we can't get a decent script, or we're still trying for one. If we don't do that, we'll most probably all do something else different, you know, for next year.
On your own?
Yes, but, I mean, it's not like breaking up. We'll still be coming back together at the end of it. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Ringo.
That's all right, thank you.
Are you going to work now?
Well, I'll see what they're up to. I think it may be tea time with any luck. Yeah. Bye. Penny Lane, there is a barber showing photographs
of every head he's had the pleasure to know. Now, that number, Penny Lane, failed to make number one in Britain, fellas. Did you feel at all put out by that?
No, it's, I don't know. The main thing is it's fine if you're kept sort of from being number one by sort of a record like Release Me. Because you're not trying to do the same kind of thing as Release Me's trying to do, you know. Yeah. So that's a completely different scene altogether, that kind of thing.
The thing is, I mean, you've obviously reached a stage where you don't have to write any more songs for any reason at all other than you like doing it. So,
but it's always been like that. That's a good thing.
Yeah.
That's the, you know, because it has been a hobby.
Mm-hmm.
And it still is, you know. Yeah. Mind you, it gets around about the time when you're doing an LP and you've got to start working. It gets like a job. But, you know, you do it in your time off anyway, so it is a hobby.
Right.
You know, so it'll go on forever, probably.
Good. Can you, without giving away any trade secrets, tell us anything about the numbers that you're engaged on at the moment for this new album that you're working on?
We've done about 9 or 10.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we've done about 9 or 10. And there's a couple of strange ones, a couple of happy-go-lucky northern songs.
Mm-hmm.
And... A couple of
whimsical, you know, folk
medieval guitar,
folk rock.
Mm. Have you this time augmented again? Use any strange lineups at all?
Yeah, we've used sort of things that aren't us, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Quite a bit.
We used the Monkees on a few of the tracks.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
But they wouldn't go along with the TV series that we had planned for them.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Has George written anything this time?
Oh yeah, he's done a great one.
Yeah.
Great one.
A great Indian one. We came along one night, had about 400 Indian fellas playing here, and it was a great swinging evening, as they say.
Yeah, so there's a few things going on.
Yeah. Is there going to be another Beatles film?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
As soon as we finish this LP, we'll be starting on this mythical film that we've been on about for the last
year. We want to do a TV show and a film, you know, so the next...
And is touring now completely out everywhere?
I reckon so, yeah.
Well, the thing is, we're working on an act where we run on in brightly coloured suits and switch on 5 tapes.
Ah, yeah, yeah.
And then we do a juggling act at the front of the stage while these tapes play Beatle melodies.
Yeah.
We're not going to write that.
All of those kind of things, though, you know, we might do in the next few years, you know, but this is the idea, to give us a chance to try other things, you know, but we don't know what they're going to be yet.
Yeah. But you are going to go on
right. Oh, there's going to be a lot more other things, you know. But we want to make them sort of different, you know.
Yeah.
You know, Brian.
Well, thanks for giving us the facts.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
They've got all these rules for everything. Rules of how to live, how to paint, how to make music. And it's just not true anymore, you know. They don't work, all those rules. Because you can't apply them, because it means then that you're assuming that you know it all. You know, and primitive man, us, and... something else, you know, and we don't know it all yet. They're talking about things that are a bit new, and they're talking about things which people don't really know too much about yet. And so, you know, people sort of put them down a bit and say, you know, weirdo, psychedelic and things. But it's really just what's going on around, and they're just trying to look into it a bit. And these other people are looking into what else it is, you know, and what else its possibilities are. And it's a straight sort of inquiry that they're doing.
But I think the big influence was Pet Sounds, Beach Boys. That was the album flipped me. Still does, actually. Still one of my favourite albums of all time. Just because the musical invention on that is like, wow. But that was the big thing for me. I just thought, oh, dear me, this is the album of all time. What the hell are we going to do? So my ideas took off from that standard, and I wanted to do stuff beyond that. So my bass playing started. I don't know if that was a direct result of that, but I was thinking along those lines. And so Sergeant Pepper kind of eventually came out, basically from the idea that I had about this band. It was going to be an album of another band that wasn't us. We were going to call ourselves, I mean, and just imagine all the time that it wasn't us playing this album. And it was just a nice little mind warp to get you to see the album. So I had this song written of Sergeant Pepper, and he was 20 years ago, and he taught us to play, and we're his proteges, and here we are. And then John had some good songs that he'd been writing at the time, Day in the Life, and to mention a few. And we worked on those and finished those, and George wasn't very involved in that album, he just had one song really. It's really the only time during the whole album, main time, I remember him turning up.
And the idea was, when you walk up to the microphone, John, you won't be John Lennon. You'll be a guy out of this group, so you can do anything you want. So that's why the uniforms are on the, you know, we went down to the tailors in Soho, Berman's. We all got measured for all the suits and everything. We did it full tilt, you know. And it kind of worked, you know. It allowed us to do crazier things than we might otherwise have done. So, I mean, the big orchestral thing in Day in the Life, that was because I'd been listening to these kind of things, you know, atonal music. And so I thought, well, I'll have a theory of my own, you know, and I'll start all the players on their lowest note and get them to creep up to the highest note and to make this kind of crazy sound. But that was because I wasn't me. I was this guy in this other group.
It's called the first concept album. It doesn't go anywhere. Mr. Kite, all my contributions have absolutely nothing to do with this idea of Sergeant Pepper and his band. But it works, because we said it worked, and that's how it appeared.
Yeah.
But it was not as put together as Pet Sounds.
Yeah.
And it doesn't have a concept. It starts out with Sergeant Pepper and introduces Billy Shears, and that's the end, apart from the so-called reprise.
Right.
Otherwise, every other song could have been on any other album.
Right, it's the reprise.
Right, Mr. Kite could have gone anywhere, Lucy could have gone anywhere, A Day in the Life could have gone anywhere. So it's not really, there's no concept.
What do you think of this new LP? It's a bit strange compared to the others. Would you term it psychedelic?
Only if you want to think of it as psychedelic.
Now I'd like to play you on. That's a sad little song. Where's it gone? Oh, this is it, yeah. Picture yourself on an old-fashioned elephant. Lucy in the sky for everyone. Now.
How long did you take over technical details like phasing?
Phasing is great.
Double flanging,
we call it. Now, there you go. Right, we're on the same thing. Flanging is great, right.
Yeah, you used it on Lucy in the Sky.
You name the one it isn't on, you know, you name it. You spot it, you get a prize, and you get a Sergeant Pepper badge.
How many takes did you usually do on this album before you got the perfect take?
We did quite a few on each one. But it's just because it's changed, you know, like in the old days of like, the LP Please Please Me, we went in and did it in a day because we knew all the numbers and... you know, they'd been, we'd rehearsed them and done them and been playing them for about a year. But nowadays we just take a song in and all we've got, you know, is the chords on a guitar and the words and the tune. So we've got to work out how to arrange it and that. So we do a lot of takes on each one. You know.
Do you like to have a lot of people in the studio when you're recording, or do you like to do it completely alone?
It doesn't matter. We had a lot of people on some of the tracks and sometimes we use them, you know, and then ask them to clap and that.
Welcome to part 8 of my Beatles album deep dive series. Today I'm talking about their 8th studio album, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. What a watershed moment for popular music. Very few rock and roll or pop albums perfectly captured the spirit or the mood of the times like Sgt. Pepper. And there have been multiple documentaries and essays written, books written about the cultural impact of Sgt. Pepper. So I'm not going to go too much into it here. I think the larger debate that exists today is how great is Sgt. Pepper and is it overrated? Has its impact been overblown or its innovation been overstated? I'm not so sure that that's the case. I think for the times, yeah, it blew a lot of people's minds. There weren't many rock and roll albums that sounded like that back in the day, so I'm not so sure there's a lot of hyperbole involved in that. Seemed like it stopped being fun for the Beatles after Sgt. Pepper. And this was kind of the last time the Beatles fully collaborated on an album where it was all for one and one for all. That being said, let's talk about Sgt. Pepper, the album. In terms of, is it the Beatles' greatest album or the greatest album of the 1960s, if not all time? I'm not so sure that's the case. I know in the 70s and 80s, there was a lot of discussion that the Beatles' masterpiece was Sgt. Pepper, and it's the greatest rock and roll album of all time. But I think people have walked that back. Critics and music fans have walked that back considerably. The most recent Rolling Stones article about the greatest 500 greatest albums of all time, like Sgt. Pepper slipped from number one all the way down to, I'm not even sure if it was in the top 20 actually anymore. And the way a lot of Beatles fans talk today, they're more apt to say Revolver or maybe the White Album or Abbey Road. White Album happens to be my favorite, but Sgt. Pepper for me is definitely in my top five. But it was the very first Beatles album that I purchased with my own money. And I think a lot of that had to do with the album packaging, because I knew it was a gatefold. There was so much to absorb here on the front cover. You got the cutouts with the insert with the album itself, and it just seemed like a very cool package. And I remember when I bought this, this would have been back in 1982, I think it was 81 or 82. That's when I started getting into the Beatles. I spent an entire Saturday in my room listening to it over and over and over again, looking at the artwork, staring at the gatefold, reading the lyrics, taking it all in. It was such a profound experience for me, and it really solidified my lifelong love and obsession for the Beatles. Now, I feel badly because in the 80s, when everybody was converting over from vinyl to CDs and the CD came out, that image was very much shrunk down. And while it's still a powerful image, something was lost in the translation from this down to this. I mean, you could still appreciate it, but here is where you get the full effect of it. But anyway, I'm not here to have an argument about artwork, CD artwork versus vinyl. I'm just making a comparison. So anyway, let's get into the album itself, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. And I will say one more thing before we get into the album. I've always saw this as kind of like a bridge for the Beatles, and bridging the carefree, happy, smiling Beatlemania mop tops from the first Beatles album through more or less Rubber Soul or Revolver. And then the Beatles started to get more serious. They started to take themselves more serious. They got a little bit more wrapped up in Eastern religion and meditation. Seemed like it stopped being fun for the Beatles after Sgt. Pepper. And this would really be the last time the Beatles collaborated on an album project where it was all for one and one for all. That being said, let's talk about Sgt. Pepper, the album. Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band was released on May 26, 1967. While not technically a concept album, the songs are presented as performances by a fictional band, with the album artwork, title track, and reprise supporting that illusion. Sgt. Pepper further advanced the experimentation and adventurous approach to songwriting and recording that began with Revolver, further pushing the boundaries of popular music and defying classification of Beatles music as purely rock and roll. The album had an enormous cultural impact upon its release, and over the years has been cited by numerous critics and publications as the greatest rock and roll album of all time. The songs themselves represented various touchstones of contemporary youth and hippie culture, such as fashion, drugs, flower power, Eastern mysticism, rebellion against the establishment, and optimism for the future. The elaborate album packaging was itself innovative and groundbreaking, containing a gatefold, cardboard cutouts, and for the first time on any pop album, lyrics to all the songs. The front cover photograph was designed by Peter Blake and Jan Hayworth and photographed by Michael Cooper. Blake envisioned the cover representing a performance in the park by the fictional Sgt. Pepper band, the audience consisting of a collection of celebrities and cultural icons that the Beatles revered. The cover collage includes 57 photographs and 9 wax figures. The Beatles' satin day-glow military outfits were a spoof of the recent fashion trend in Britain. The wax figures of the Beatles in their suits and mop-top haircuts from the days of Beatlemania were borrowed from Madame Tussauds Museum. Sgt. Pepper topped the UK album charts for 23 consecutive weeks and sold 250,000 copies in its first week. The album held the number one position on the Billboard Top LP charts in the US for 15 weeks. The first track recorded for the album, which in its initial stages was intended to be thematically about the Beatles' childhoods, was Strawberry Fields Forever. John had written the song in Almeria, Spain during a break from filming How I Won the War, and when he returned home, he began recording a series of demos. The song referred to a Salvation Army children's home near his home in Woolton, where he would attend numerous summer garden parties. Recording took 45 hours spread over 5 weeks. The song was eventually recorded in 2 separate arrangements, which George Martin edited together when John could not decide which version he preferred.
I could get them almost in line with each other from a rhythmic point of view. I got them in line with each other from a tone point of view. And I cut the two together, and the cut I can hear in my sleep. I know exactly where it is. It sticks out like a sore thumb, but most people don't know. And when John heard it, he said, "You see, I told you. I knew you could do it." And he just regarded it as normal, you know, you can do that kind of thing. But it was a question of getting hold of a bit of tape and with a pair of brass scissors cutting it and joining it up again. Nowadays, you don't have to do that.
Receiving pressure from Capitol Records in America, Strawberry Fields Forever would be released as a double A-sided single in advance of the album on February 13th, 1967, with Penny Lane as the flip side.
Let me take you down, that's it.
Yeah.
It's just about me, really. Mm-hmm. Or anybody else that is thinking like that.
Let me take you down, cause I'm going to Strawberry Fields.
Penny Lane was Paul's contribution to the childhood nostalgia theme of the album, and is titled after a road in Liverpool that Paul used to travel often by bus as a youth. The basic track was recorded on December 29th with an overdubbing session taking place on January 4th, the first session of the new year. The single reached number 1 in the US, but only number 2 in the UK. The lead-off track and title song, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, was written by Paul based on the concept of Beatles performing an entire album as alter egos. He conceived of the idea on a flight from Kenya to England following a holiday trip. Recording began on February 1st, 1967, and was completed with 3 additional sessions on March 6th. The audience noises that were dubbed onto the track had been recorded by George Martin in the early 60s during a live performance of the stage show Beyond the Fringe. The orchestra tune-up was a recording from the sessions for A Day in the Life. The song transitions into the next track with a little help from my friends. John and Paul finished writing the song in the middle of March 1967, and recording began on March 29th. The basic track consisted of Ringo on drums, Paul on piano, George on lead guitar, and John playing a cowbell. Ringo recorded his vocals at the end of the session, with the other Beatles standing around the microphone for moral support. The following day, tambourine, backing vocals, bass, and additional electric guitar were added. The working title of the song was Bad Finger Boogie, after John composed the melody on piano using his middle finger because his forefinger was injured at the time.
Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends. I get high with a little help from my friends.
Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds was written by John, inspired by a picture his son Julian had drawn of a classmate named Lucy.
Let me confirm quickly a couple rumors with you.
Yes.
One of them, has it ever been settled whether Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds was a code for anything?
It never was, and nobody believes me. I even saw some famous star introducing, I've forgotten who it was, introducing a Lennon McCartney show, and it was Mel Torme saying about how Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds was about LSD. This is the truth. My son came home with a drawing and said, showed me this strange-looking woman flying around. I said, what is it? He said, it's Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. And I thought, that's beautiful. I immediately wrote a song about it. Uh-huh. The song had gone out, the whole album had been published, and somebody noticed that the letters spelt out LSD. And I had no idea about it. And, of course, after that, I was checking all the songs to see what the letters spelled out. Yeah. They didn't spell out anything, none of the others, and it wasn't about that at all, you know.
John has said the lyrics were derived from Lewis Carroll's book Alice in Wonderland. Paul claims he provided John with the newspaper taxis and cellophane flowers lines. The Beatles rehearsed the song on February 28th with the instrumental backing containing a guide vocal by John completed on March 1st. On take 8 of the song, John's guide vocal was wiped from the track and replaced with a tambura played by George. John's double-track vocals and Paul's backing vocals were added on March 2nd. A final mono mix was created on March 3rd. Getting Better was co-written by John and Paul, and the title was allegedly inspired by a phrase often used by drummer Jimmy Nicol, who substituted for Ringo on the Australian leg of their 1964 tour. Paul claims the phrase popped into his head one morning when he was walking his sheepdog Martha. The clash between the more positive and optimistic lyrics in the song and those with a darker, more negative tone reflect the different perspectives of the two songwriters. John contributed the "can't get no worse" counterpoint to Paul's "getting better all the time," as well as the lines about being cruel to his woman.
That's Paul and me, his main lick, but lots of the words and parts and bits from me and possibly the others in the studio. All that, I used to be cruel to my woman and beat her, that's me, because I used to be cruel to my woman and physically, any woman. You know, I was a hitter. I couldn't express myself, and I fought men, I hit women, I was violent. That's why I'm always on about peace, you see. It's the most violent people that go for love and peace. And I sincerely believe in love and peace, but I am absolutely a violent man who has learned not to be violent and regrets his violence.
The chorus and just the idea for it.
Is this Getting Better? Yeah. Getting Better is his chorus, and then both together writing the sort of Chuck Berry-ish sounding, but I know that input about beating and all that was from me, and the references to school and things like that. Getting so much better.
Fixing a Hole was written by Paul about his recent experimentation with LSD and ongoing love affair with marijuana. In his book, The Lyrics, Paul claims he saw a vision of a little blue hole under the influence of LSD. The lines about the people standing there who disagree and never win refer to fans who gathered outside his home. The song was recorded in two separate sessions, the first on February 9th at Regent Sound Studios in London, as all of Abbey Road Studios had been booked for the evening. A second session on February 21st was used for overdubbing. For the first time since 1964, Paul's lead vocal was recorded at the same time as the rhythm track, rather than being overdubbed later. George Martin plays the harpsichord on the track. She's Leaving Home was written and sung by John and Paul, Paul writing and singing the verses, and John writing and singing the chorus. The orchestral backing was written and arranged by Mike Leander, as George Martin was not available for the session. The lyrics were inspired by a front page story in the Daily Mail newspaper about Melanie Coe, a girl who disappeared from her family home to run off with her boyfriend while her parents were asleep. Ironically, Paul had met Melanie when the Beatles appeared on Ready, Steady, Go back in 1963, and Paul picked her as the winner of a dance contest.
I wonder if our panel of judges has made up its mind and is unanimous.
Oh, yes, it has.
It is. It has. Yes. Paul, who's it going to be?
I think the winner, as far as I'm concerned, number four.
Number four, Melanie Coe.
Neither George nor Ringo perform on the track. The stereo version of the song runs slower than the mono mix. The final mono mix was sped up to make Paul sound younger. Being for the Benefit of Mr. Kite was written by John based on the text of a 19th century circus poster he had purchased at an antique shop on January 31st during a break from filming the promotional films for Strawberry Fields and Penny Lane.
It's from a Victorian poster which I bought you have to let me show it to you. You might even want to print it. It's so cosmically beautiful from that period that everything is on this one poster for Pablo Fanke's Fair, which is a genuine thing that must have happened in the 1800s. I bought it in a junk shop, and everything is from there except for the horse wasn't called Henry. Now, there was all stories about Henry the horse being heroin. I'd never seen heroin at that period. And that was mine from a poster which almost has the whole story in it about turning somersets in Victorian days, turning so many somersaults. And Mr. Kite and all those names are all exactly on this Victorian poster.
That's what it's about, just to say.
Yeah, I used to have it hanging on the wall and I just sang it. I had the piano, looked around, there was this whole story, so I just sang it.
It was recorded on February 17th with overdubs added on February 20th.
For the benefit of Mr. Kite.
For the benefit of Mr. Kite, this is take one.
George Martin used recordings of fairground organs and calliope music randomly spliced together for the instrumental breaks. Martin plays a Hammond organ sped up on the final recording to add to the circus atmosphere. Within You, Without You was written by George at Klaus Voormann's house, inspired by his trip to India in late 1966, and friendship with musician Ravi Shankar, who agreed to mentor him on the sitar. The lyrics were based on a conversation between George and Klaus on the metaphysical spaces that prevent people from recognizing the natural forces uniting the world and reflect the growing influence of Eastern philosophy in his songwriting. Like his previous composition, Love You Too, the arrangement incorporates Indian classical instruments such as the sitar, tambura, and tabla, and were performed primarily by the Asian Music Circle under George's direction. The song was recorded on March 15th in a darkened, candlelit studio with burning incense and Indian tapestries hanging on the wall to evoke the proper atmosphere. George and the Beatles' road manager, Neil Aspinall, play tambura on the track. When I'm 64 is a bouncy cabaret-style song, one of the earliest written by Paul, based on a melody he had composed when he was 14. John helped Paul with a few of the lines, including the names of the grandchildren and the lyric about digging the weeds. The clarinet trio were scored by George Martin. The basic tracks were recorded in two takes on December 6, 1966, during the first sessions for the album. Paul overdubbed his lead vocal without the other Beatles present on December 8th. On December 21st, the clarinets were overdubbed onto the rhythm track. Still dissatisfied with the results, Paul directed the engineers to speed up the tape slightly, raising the key nearly a semitone from C major to D major so his voice would sound higher.
Will you still need me? Will you still feed me?
Lovely Rita was written by Paul after hearing the American term meter maid. The song was mostly written at his brother Michael's house in Liverpool, with John supplying some additional help with lyrics in the studio. The Beatles began recording the basic rhythm track on February 23rd, with an additional bass guitar part overdubbed by Paul. Additional vocals were added on February 24th, with heavy tape echo under John's direction. Paul's voice was recorded with the tape speed reduced, so his voice sounded higher when corrected. Members of Pink Floyd, who were in an adjacent studio recording the Piper at the Gates of Dawn album, were present for the mixing of the song on March 21st. Good Morning, Good Morning was written by John and inspired by a commercial for Kellogg's Corn Flakes.
Good morning, good morning.
Good morning is mine, a throwaway piece of garbage, I always thought. It's just not one of my favorite pieces because, you know, at the same time I wrote Mr. Kite and Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, and Day in the Life. So if you line them up against those three, Good Morning doesn't really stand up. So that's why I don't have much of a feeling about it, you know. But it's fun, the kind of the sound effects and the
by the way, was from a Kellogg's commercial. Because I always had the TV on very low in the background when I was writing.
The basic rhythm track was recorded on February 8th with overdubs completed on February 16th. The guitar solo was played by Paul on a Fender Esquire. British instrumental group Sounds Incorporated supplied the brass backing. Engineer Jeff Emmerich arranged the animal noises at the end of the song in a sequence where each animal herd was capable of devouring the one preceding it. The final sound of a chicken clucking was added to segue into the first guitar note heard at the beginning of Sgt. Pepper's reprise. Sgt. Pepper's reprise was written at the suggestion of road manager Neil Aspinall, who thought that since the original Sgt. Pepper song was a welcome song, there should also be a goodbye song at the end of the album. The Beatles recorded the song on April 1st, 2 months after the original version. Sections written by John, and the middle section, which begins with Woke Up, Fell Out of Bed, written by Paul. The lyrics were inspired by recent news stories, including an article on the death of Guinness heir and socialite Tara Brown, who had been killed in a car crash running a red light while driving intoxicated in December of 1966. Brown had given Paul his first dose of LSD in 1966 at his home in Belgravia. The line, 4,000 holes in Blackburn, Lancashire, was taken from an article in the Daily Mail about road excavations in Blackburn, with the now they know how many holes it takes to fill the Albert Hall lyric suggested by John's friend Terry Doran. The English Army had just won the war lyric references John's role in the movie How I Won the War. The BBC originally banned the song because of the implied drug reference in the line, I'd love to turn you on. Recording began on January 19th with a rehearsal consisting of John on piano, Paul on Hammond organ, George on acoustic guitar, and Ringo on congas before four takes of the rhythm track were taped with John switching to acoustic guitar and George playing maracas. At the end of the session, the transition from John's opening section to Paul's middle section consisted of a repeated piano note and roadie Mal Evans counting out each of the 24 bars on the bridge. The track was then remixed and additional overdubs were added on January 20th and February 3rd. The orchestral section was recorded on February 10th, for which the Beatles invited a number of guests, including Mick Jagger, Keith Richards, Brian Jones, Mike Nesmith, Donovan, and Marianne Faithfull. The final piano chord, played simultaneously by John, Paul, Ringo, and roadie Mal Evans, was recorded on February 22nd. The total time spent recording A Day in the Life was 34 hours. So that is my take on Sgt. Pepper. I hope you've enjoyed this episode. I know it ran a little long. I hope you're enjoying the series. Have a great day and take care.